upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory. And amen. I hope that our vision of Christ will come a little clearer during these days. Amen. Thank you for your giving tonight. Just personal curiosity, let me see the hands of all you fellows and girls who are here but students in one of our Bible colleges. Would you raise your hand, right? Let me just see where all you are. Wave them just a tiny bit so I can see. There's a bunch of them over here. Thank you so much for being here. Appreciate it very, very deeply. And we're thankful to the staff and the teachers who are also here and the schools that made it possible for you to come for this special event. I personally think it's a special honor to have Dr. Paul Kauffman with us to bring us the first message of this conference or camp meeting, as Brother Parker reminded us. And we welcome him. He has been in our schools. He's been in our churches. He's been in our camps, he's been in our ministerials, but he always has something fresh and good and anointed, and we welcome him to the pulpit tonight, Dr. Paul Kauffman. I'm sorry, Dr. Paul. I didn't realize that we have another special song, and we don't want to miss that. So come, gentlemen or gentlewomen. Come on, or is it a congregational song? All right.
In loving kindness, Jesus came, my soul in mercy to reclaim, and from the depths of sin and shame, through grace he lifted me. From sinking sand he lifted me, with tender hand he lifted me. From shades of night when I took him at his word, forgiven, he lifted me. From sinking sand, he lifted me. With tender hand, he lifted me. From shades of night, on a higher plane I dwell, and with my soul I know 'tis well. Not how or why, well I cannot tell, that he should have lifted me. Listen, from sinking sand I'm glad he lifted me. With tender hand he lifted me. From shades a night to flames of love. Oh, praise his name. He lifted me from shades of
Brother Cassidy, beautiful song, beautifully sung. Well, it's an honor to be here this evening. I was awfully anxious, so I came an hour early just to get here. A little discouraged when too many people around then. I thought, well, actually things have started off for me pretty badly yesterday morning. I got to the airport at Pittsburgh, stopped at my student's parsonage and picked him up. He takes me to the airport and drops me off. I've been flying out of Pittsburgh for 20-some years, and I've never paid a dollar to park a car. It's nice to have students who are pastoring nearby. So carefully, I packed everything, and I hopped out of the car, and I looked down, and I had on my wife has me wear a pair of slip-on tennis shoes around the house, and I had on the coolest blue tennis shoes you ever saw. I was the coolest dude in Pittsburgh Airport yesterday morning. I even put a picture on Facebook. Things have kind of gone downhill ever since then. Sitting here tonight, he has a stand. Out of the corner of my eye, I see Brother Sankey's not standing. John's not standing, so I'll sit there a while. After a while, Brother Sankey gets up. Now, are we standing or are we sitting? Half a verse later, John gets up. And I said, what, halfway through the song, do I get up, you know, or do I sit there and look like an old man that's infirm or what? Anyhow, it's good to be here with you. The last time I was here was 5 years ago, this very month. We were fleeing a hurricane in Hope Sound. And you haven't lived until you've traveled 27 hours on a bus with students from Hope Sound to Pell City. We made headlines. They had news reporters out here with cameras interviewing the students as they got off. That was 5 years ago. And Dr. Alan Brown and I, we preached together here a few years ago. We were co-evangelists. It's nice to be at Pell City. Boy, they treat you well here. I am getting a little older. I look around trying to see how many of you are any older than I am tonight. Let me tell you what happened to illustrate my point. I was a student at the Hebrew University in Baltimore. I commuted from Hagerstown, where I was pioneering a church, 89 miles to my classes. I tell my students I learned Hebrew on Interstate 70. It's a good place to do flashcards and memorize paradigm. So I was in this class on Iron Age archaeology. Dr. Gitlin was one of those hotshot professors, one of Pritchard's students. And we had to do a paper on some ancient city. So I went by his office. I said, Dr. Gitlin, I think I'm going to do the city of Gezer. Oh, no, Paul. He said, it's not Gezer. He said, it's Gezer. Said, Gezer's an old city, Gezer's an old man. So, Dr. Brown, I learned how to pronounce the word Gezer, you know, the two segals, short E's. And then I thought of the people down here. A lot of you people I think I know. I recognize faces, but getting faces and names together can be a bit of a challenge. But I don't want to do what one fellow did. I heard him on the radio a few weeks ago. Fellow was a Nazarene, I think maybe a general superintendent. Said he'd been on the road 250 days out of the preceding year. Says, I meet a lot of people and I hate to acknowledge that I don't know them. But he said, I don't want to be like that one fellow. He said he was standing in the back in the big crowd and he's shaking hands with a lady and a man walks by and he said, and how's your lovely wife doing? Well, he said, you might ask her, you're shaking hands with her. So if I don't remember your name, cut me a little slack, will you? But I feel like I'm among friends tonight, really. I've asked people, I said, now, what are you expecting out of a message like this tonight? You expecting camp meeting preaching? You want a lot of illustrations and an altar call? Is this camp meeting? Or you want something very scholastic? And it's interesting, the feedback I get from preachers and students. Everybody's just kind of wondering how it's all going to go. We've had the School of the Prophets, and Brother Plank, I'm glad you caught the vision to start it up again. I gave a presentation at Penn View in the year 2000, and I remember that. We've had them in different colleges, and I'm just really delighted what we're doing. School of the Prophets. Elijah, Elisha, Samuel talks about the School of the Prophets. Is this for sermons? Is this for lectures? What are we going to do here? I'm glad for all the students that are here. There are some that I was missing already. I talked to Dr. Mark Bird on Monday. I called him to congratulate him for having dedicated God's revivalist to him. I said, now I'll see you this weekend. Well, he stammered a little bit and said, you know, I got this wedding I got to go to. A few hours later, I was talking to Tim Cole up in North Carolina. I said, now I'll see you there. Well, he said, we really wanted to come, but he said, we've got this grandson in Ohio. So I can see that weddings and grandkids are a lot more important than School of the Prophets, but I'm glad for those of you who are here. But to see how we get along. Brother Plank called me, I don't know, 6-7 months ago, asked me if I would speak. Then he wanted a topic. Now, how in the world do you commit to a topic 6 months ahead of time before you've had a chance to really pray and think about it? So the very least you do is get something that's rather broad so you got a little bit of room to maneuver under there. But you know, my topic has sort of caught fire with me, and I like to say happiness for a preacher is knowing what you're supposed to preach. That's half the battle. So I want you to know, whether I get it out very well tonight, I want you to know I'm happy about my topic. You pray for me, and I want to share with you. Now, I don't see a clock, and that's okay. My watch is off. I thought sure we were still in Eastern Standard Time here, but anyhow, I don't see any clocks. And I tell people I spend more time behind a lectern than I do behind a pulpit, Brother Plank. Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, you kind of get used to 55-minute lectures. Tuesdays and Thursdays, they're an hour and a half. Tonight, you need to pray that I'm on my Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, not on my 3-hour. You teachers know what I'm talking about. The topic is the progressive revelation of truth. And I've thought a lot about this through the spring and the summer, and the degrees of perfection. So I want to share some thoughts about this with you this evening. And I'm talking mostly to students. You older codgers, you've pretty well become what you're going to be. It's like the dean when we go over end of course evaluations at the end of each semester. I'll sit down in the dean's office, whether it's a seminary or wherever I happen to be at the time. Dr. Churchill, he and I go over my evaluations, and he'll say, now you might think about this, you know, a little bit of this, tweak it a little bit. I say, I said, let's don't kid each other. I've pretty well become the kind of teacher I'm going to be, and we're not going to be changing anything real radically from here on out. And that's probably how it is. So I'm thinking of students this evening, and I'm just giving you a lecture tonight. Now, Dr. Dennis is one of my heroes. I read one of his devotionals this morning, and a lot of people use his. I have mine on Kindle, and I can use them wherever I am. He tells of a professor who urged the students to stop underlining their favorite passages in Scripture. He had a professor. He said, I can just about tell you what you have underlined. Kinloff points that out. He says, you need to think beyond what you've got underlined. You need to be thinking of the verse, the chapter, the book. In other words, give it a context within the book. And he said, the fun began when I found myself catching glimmers of biblical truth that bound it all together from Genesis clear to Revelation. That's the big context, is God's word. Talk about context. I followed a man in my second church, my second pastorate. He had started the church and preached there for 44 years. Great soul winner. I have great admiration for him. But I'd been there maybe 6-8 months, and somebody came up to me and said, "We've never heard a sermon from the Old Testament. This is new stuff to us. How do you preach 44 years and overlook the Old Testament?" Well, I missed something there. Talk about context. Well, he was a mighty soul winner. He reached people I'll never reach. But the people were beginning to catch sight. There's something a little bit bigger than just the Gospels and the New Testament. And we need to think that way this evening. The way to help your congregation is to help them to see the big issue and to understand how God and His wisdom starts small and slowly unfolds this thing as it goes along. And I think there's several points of truth that I want to try to share with you tonight. It's a progressive revelation. Students are constantly asking me, and a lot of what I say nowadays from the pulpit is in response to students' classroom discussions. The question comes up, how much of the Old Testament should we still be observing? If a son speaks evil of his parents, we don't execute him nowadays. But you did in the Old Testament. Do we follow the Levitical formula when we deal with the suspected adulteress? Or how about this business of Noah was a perfect man, Job was a perfect man? How can they be perfect? Christ hasn't even come yet, let alone Pentecost, and yet they're perfect. Bezalel, was he sanctified when he was filled with the Spirit to make the furniture for the ark? For the tabernacle? And how can the Spirit come on Samson when he's interacting with prostitutes? How do you explain that? And part of that all comes under this broad umbrella of progressive revelation. Now, I want to read some scripture this evening. I'm going to read from the book of Ezekiel, chapter 47, the first couple of verses. As I was thinking about this, one day it just lit up to me. This is just exactly what I'm trying to say. There's a neat analogy there about the water from the temple. I'm in Ezekiel 47, first 5 verses. Afterward, he brought me again unto the door of the house, and behold, waters issued out from under the threshold of the house eastward. For the forefront of the house stood toward the east, and the waters came down from under the right side of the house at the south side of the altar. Verse 2. Then brought me he out of the way of the gate northward, and led me about the way unto the utter gate, by the way that looketh eastward, and behold, there went waters, ran out waters on the right side. And when the man that had the line in his hand went forth eastward, he measured 1,000 cubits, and he brought me through the waters, and the waters were to the ankles. Again he measured 1,000, and brought me through the waters, and the waters were to his knees. And again he measured 1,000, and brought me through the waters that were to his loins, to the loins. And afterward he measured 1,000, and it was a river that I could not pass over, for the waters were risen, waters to swim in, a river that could not be passed over. To me, that's an interesting analogy of how a small trickle becomes a stream, becomes a river. It just occurred to me one day what God began to unfold in the book of Genesis was just a little trickle, and He just keeps opening it up and opening up. It just gets bigger and better. God is in the business of perfecting His work. He's just not finished yet. Many times the question comes up in the classroom, and you faculty people here tonight, people want to know, why 2 works of grace? Don't we serve a God great enough He can save us, He can go ahead and sanctify us at the same time? And you know, one day, not very often, but every once in a while, I'll have an original thought. I'm a great borrower, but every once in a while, I'll just see something that I never read in a commentary, never saw. This business of why 2 works of grace. And it occurred to me, on the first day of creation, God says, let there be light. He creates nothing but light on day 1. And it occurred to me, you know what? Each day, God did something else, and nobody would attribute anything but utter perfection to whatever God does. Could he have done the creation in one day instead of six? Of course he could have. But he didn't. And what he did each day was perfect. And that helped me to catch sight of the fact, why does God have two works of grace? Is there something defective about the first work of grace? Absolutely not. It's a perfect work of grace. He's just not complete yet. And once I saw that creation analogy, that helped me to help students have a little insight into why God. Now, we know we're dealing with two types of sin. Of course, it takes two different works of God to deal with that. So let's see how this thing unfolds. Whatever God does is perfect, but he's just not finished yet. Now, I looked up this word progressive revelation. And you people all, you know, it's one of the early chapters in your theology books. One theologian said it's the doctrine in Christianity that understands that sections of the Bible that were written later contain a fuller revelation of God than the earlier sections, leading to a more complete revelation. So just like the stream that Ezekiel saw, God starts small, and then he begins to unfold it and progressive. Now the key is, it's not from error to truth, it's from revealed truth to more fully revealed truth. Never from error to truth. The progressive character of divine revelation can be observed in all the great doctrines of the Bible. And the more I thought about this, the more I began to see some things I'd never noticed before. What at first was only obscure is gradually unfolded in subsequent parts of the sacred volume until the truth is finally revealed in its fullness. God's revelation, or his apocalypsis, his self-disclosure, begins first of all with the person of God. The very first thing God has to do is introduce himself to his creation. From a deity that is utterly unapproachable to one who desires to come down and dwell in our hearts. God is transcendent. Now I can use that word around you people. He's transcendent. The deists like to talk about a transcendent God. He's a God who never involves himself with the affairs of man. No miracles in their theology, no virgin-born son of God. For them, God is always somewhere out there in the mystical beyond. All they do credit him as being the creator. He creates the world and then he leaves it, one of them said, as an absentee landlord. God sits on his throne somewhere out there as a transcendent God. But God did reveal himself to us, and he becomes immanent, the opposite of transcendent. He sends his son, Emmanuel, God with us. He leaves that transcendent place of heaven and comes down. Now, God's ultimate plan, his aim, is that his holiness should be created, his kingdom should be established in the hearts and lives of his followers. Now, in Scripture, apparently God came down. Genesis says the Lord came down, the Hebrew says, in the wind of the day. Perhaps the afternoon breezes picked up. And on a regular basis, God came down and talked with Adam and Eve. Of course, until the fall when he hid himself. So from a God who is visiting on a regular basis, once the fall, God begins to back off. He will speak in visions or somehow reveals himself little by little. He moves from the one who can be known as the friend of God with Abraham to a deity who can shake mountains and destroy those who approach unto the mountain, Mount Sinai. And he comes all the way down to where he wants to set up his kingdom in the hearts of his followers. Moses, to God to Moses was that I am that I am. That was a name he said, I was not known to the patriarchs. He begins to unfold himself now. Yahweh is much more intimate than Elohim and El Shaddai. It's when God comes out of the abstract into the concrete in a face-to-face encounter with humanity. That's sort of what happened when that veil was rent in the temple. God is opening himself up to a more full disclosure, to to his people. The transcendent God becomes immanent, and that's all part of God's progressive revelation. The same thing happens in the revelation of the Son. He gradually unfolds the Son to us. His ultimate revelation is found in Jesus Christ, as revealed in the Gospels. So too, here's a more complete disclosure of God who is in the person of Jesus. Now, Augustine tells us, or St. Augustine, as my Orthodox friend likes to pronounce it, he tells us the Old Testament is the New Testament concealed. You know this. The New Testament is the Old Testament revealed. Augustine understood progressive revelation. And from these examples, we can turn to an inspired summary statement of progressive revelation. And God shares it to us in the Hebrew letter. In verse 1, he says, God, who at various times and in various ways spoke in times past to the fathers by the prophets, including Moses, he hath in these last days spoken to us by his Son. It's the full disclosure of God through his Son. And the bold implication of this passage is that a qualitative difference exists between Moses and the prophets, of course, then Christ and the apostles. Now, this distinction becomes ever more clear as the epistle of the Hebrews progresses. Notice he piles up reasons why Jesus the Son is better than Moses, why those who lay hold on Christ by faith have a better hope. We have a better priesthood. We have a better covenant based on better promises than those who rely on the old covenant with all of its Levitical laws and its legal examples apart from grace. Another example would be in particular standards like the distinction between clean and unclean. We don't talk about clean and unclean animals anymore. That's old stuff. That was done away with. It may have been valid prior to Christ, but following the arrival of Christ, there's no longer any obligation to maintain this distinction between and unclean animals. That was a ceremonial law. I'm surprised at how many people don't make distinctions between the ceremonial law, the civil law, and the moral. The moral law is timeless. It always was, it always will be. But the Hebrew writer says a lot of that stuff is done away with. I'm not sure why we go back there to build some of our doctrines. I've never met anyone in the conservative holiness movement who argues for clean or unclean animals. Why not? Or for a new mother to bring a sin offering after she gives the birth to a child. Why would you do that? That's the old covenant. And then we move to a few more definitive terms like dispensations and covenants that God chose to work through. The term progressive revelation refers to the idea and teaching that God revealed various aspects of his will and his overall plan for humanity over different periods of times. These have been referred to as dispensations by some theologians. Now, actually, that's a biblical term. Ephesians 1:10, we find the word dispensation. He said that in the dispensation of the fullness of times, he might gather together in one all things in Christ, both which are in heaven, which are on earth, even in him. There are three ages or three dispensations. We talk about the patriarchal period. Historians love to periodize things. The patriarch starts with Abraham and ends with the Exodus when they get up to the borders of Canaan. Then there's the Mosaic dispensation, and of course the New Testament church age. Or we can talk in terms of covenants. There are probably five different covenants we can talk about. When Noah came out of the ark, there was the Noahic covenant. Then there was the Abrahamic covenant. Then the Mosaic covenant, the Davidic covenant. And now, thank God, we have the new covenant. All of these reveal a steady onward progression. The stream now is becoming a river, soon to become a flood. Now, I want to show you, I got a lot of help from John Fletcher. I don't know how many of you people read Fletcher's works. They were finally, I think Schmuel did them years ago, four volumes. My old spiritual father, C.R. McPherson, introduced me to Fletcher. He's a powerful writer. Interestingly enough, he was trained in Geneva. He grew up on Tulip and five-point Calvinism, and then he became probably the best apologist for Methodism. Even Wesley learned from him. Probably the word grudgingly is not an apt word to use, but Wesley loved Fletcher. He said he was more like an angel than any man he'd ever met. He wanted Fletcher to preach his own funeral. Unfortunately, it turned around and Fletcher died first. But Fletcher actually helped Wesley to see some things, and I'm going to say a little bit about how Wesley moved from some gradual insights to more fully expanded insights. And I like to share with my students Fletcher's, I call him his degrees of perfection. That's not his term, but it's very apt, and I like to use it. You'll find this in his last check to antinomianism. First of all, he starts with Noah. He said Noah was a just man and perfect in his generation. That's the qualifier. Simply means he was walking in all the light that he had. In God's eyes, if you're walking in all your light, you're a perfect person. That certainly wouldn't be the way that's not the word we would use to define it. But for God to say Noah was a perfect man, Fletcher starts with him. Then he moves to start the patriarchal period. He comes to Abraham, chapter 17 of Genesis, verse 1. I'm Almighty God, I'm El Shaddai, walk before me and be thou perfect. And then there's Job. Job is an interesting one. There was a man whose name was Job. God said that man was perfect and upright and one that feared God and eschewed evil. Somebody shooting at me? Did I do something wrong? He eschewed evil. He inclined away from evil. 13 times in the book of Job, he's called a perfect man. But there's another term I like. This is a new one. Do you like it when you learn something new? Every once in a while, I'll find something brand new. And I came across this word, integrity. After God challenges Satan with his man Job, Satan says, you don't understand. He's just serving you because you made him a millionaire. Take away all of his toys and see if he still loves you. So God lets him do that. We understand the hedge was moved in a little bit. Job loses everything. Now here's the point I want to notice. The second time when the sons of God appear before God, I call it the control room of heaven, God says to him, he says, my man Job still retains his integrity. Now that's a new word to me. Oh, I know the word exists. But I looked at it. Do you know the word integrity is related to the word integer? And in mathematics, integer is a whole number. What God is saying is, my man Job, he retains his wholeness. He's got an eye single to God's glory. James says a double-minded man's unstable in all of his ways. And Job in chapter 27, he says, I will maintain my integrity. Ties in very nicely with that word, perfect. Job insisted that he was not going to have a divided heart or divided motives. And so Job was perfect in his generation. Now, Job made mistakes. Job made some false judgments. He actually criticizes God on a couple of occasions. But with what light he had, it was God who said he's a perfect man. He's walking all of his light. Now, here's where Fletcher gets interesting. Fletcher uses analogies. He starts with the butterfly and the larva and the cocoon. He says that worm starts off as a cocoon. It's a perfect worm, but it's still a worm. He said, just hang around a little bit. That thing will finally crawl out of the end of that cocoon, and he'll become a beautiful butterfly. Perfect at both stages. That's his point. And then he says, let's go to what he calls the orchardist. Why, he says, we'll go to the tree and there's a perfect blossom. Not ready to eat it yet, but it's perfect. It's in the process of becoming, and finally it'll become a perfect fruit. We move then from Noah and Abraham and Job, we go now to the Mosaic dispensation. Now we've got tables of stone. Ratified by blood. We have a legal system with legal definitions of everything, including sin. The most for one's motives. Doesn't matter what your motive was. The law says this, you do it. Come back to that in a little bit. The next step, Fletcher tells us then, is when God takes this law, this external unbending law, and he internalizes it and moves it into the hearts of the people now. Moves it out of the tabernacle, and he wants to internalize the law. He says, there's coming a day when I'm going to write this on the flesh of your heart. It's gradually unfolding. Next, Fletcher says, is John the Baptist, his baptism of regeneration. And what he says as he goes along is that it's like we're going up a ladder, and each one of these is a step up the ladder, the one before it. And once then, of course, is Christ himself with his Sermon on the Mount. For Fletcher, that's the top rung of the ladder. It doesn't get any better than that. We moved all the way from Noah and Abraham and Moses and the prophets. We get to the top rung of the ladder. Holiness or perfection, I want you to know, is on a sliding scale. And the closer we come to the New Testament, the closer we get to the walk that God desires for his children. It's beginning to come into focus now. An excellent example of the progression of light in the soul. You know, God begins to speak to you very dimly. Do you remember the first time you heard God speak to you? And then you begin to understand a little bit more and a little bit more. When we find Cornelius, he's a devout man. He's doing all he knows. He has apparently natural religion plus his conscience. Now, when Peter starts preaching at his house, he said, but he was accepted by God. God said so, and he's a candidate for the baptism of the Spirit, which is going to happen by the time Peter's done there. So Cornelius moves from a little bit to a more progressive revelation to where he understands what's going on. And it's all about in chapter 15. And students today are still struggling. How much of the Old Testament is still binding on us? That was the problem for Peter. Okay, so we have the way, we have this new gospel. But when a Gentile gets converted, how much of the old stuff does he have to do? We know how that all played out. That's a topic for another school of the prophets down the road. Bottom line is, Old Testament saints were saved by faith, the same as we are today. They just possessed much fewer details, and that's what the Hebrew writer is talking about again and again. God saved them based on their response to what knowledge, what light they did have. Their faith was looking forward to something they could not see. Scripture teaches that God has always given people enough revelation to exercise faith. And now that Christ's work is accomplished, the requirement has changed. The times of ignorance are over now. Now we've got the full light of God's truth. We've got to move beyond that. Acts tells us he overlooked the times of ignorance. He now declares to men that all people everywhere should repent. So how do you and I then live in a manner that be pleasing to God with the full revelation that we have now? Genesis 3:15, that famous proto-evangelium, that first gospel, God promises a cure for the sin problem in a very concealed way. I'm sure Eve didn't understand at all what God was saying to her about her seed crushing the head of the serpent. It sets the stage of anticipation to man's problem with sin. It's the beginning. The Hebrew writer picks up on this in chapter 7. He says, so the form by which we draw near to God. And the Hebrew writer develops that again and again. Won't take time to read that. Chapter 10, verse 1 and 2 said, for the law, having a shadow of good things to come, not the very image, can never with those sacrifices which they offered year by year continually make the comers thereunto perfect. For then they would not have ceased to have been offered, because that the worshippers once purged should have no more conscience of sin. So Fletcher has helped me immensely, and I have found if I find something that helps me and I share it with you, it just might help you. I thank God for the saintly John Fletcher. Now, you students, as you're reaching out to the world around you, you're going to have to help people understand how they deal with this issue of sin. I thank God. I started off in a storefront with 12 people in downtown Hagerstown, Maryland. I told the conference, I said, I'll go there if there's any hope of building a church. I don't plan on staying in a storefront the rest of my life. Guys, it was pitiful. That's a good way for every young man to start off, though. The only way you can go is up. It can't get any worse. Didn't need a lawnmower. There was no lawn. There was no parking. Invite people to church. No place for them to park. Half a block down the road, they might come. How are you going to get new people interested in a church like that? I said I raised my daughters on a fire escape. They didn't have any place to play outside. But I went there. Well, what's sin? How do you preach it? Sin in the Old Testament is very legal. It has no bend to it. It doesn't take into consideration what your motive was. I'd like to use the example of Uzzah. Do you remember when David was moving the ark toward Jerusalem? And of course, they should have been carrying this thing on poles, on those rings. Instead, they've got it on a cart. And Uzzah reaches out to steady the ark. Certainly a good motive, but it didn't count for anything in the Old Testament. Doesn't matter how good his motive was. God says, you don't touch the ark. Boom. He falls over dead. He has a good motive, but under a legal definition of sin, it counts for nothing. Now, what's interesting in the book of Acts, here's Ananias and Sapphira. They're doing what looks like a good deed. They're selling property and bringing money into the church. They should have got some recognition for that. Instead, they both die within 3 hours of each other. They did a good deed with a rotten motive. I'm telling you, God's more interested in your motive than what you do. That'll judge the rightness or wrongness of your moral choices. Now, I could walk up to John Parker, and I want to give him a compliment. And so as best I can, I hand out my compliment to him. But somehow in my humanness, I don't say it quite right. The wrong voice inflection, he doesn't catch it. In fact, he got offended at what I said. I walk away. In God's eyes, I get credit for giving him a compliment because that's what I meant to do. Although I may later find out that I offended him and have to go back and apologize for it. The old Methodist aphorism, students, and don't ever forget this, the motive stands in place of the deed. You got to process that, I know. The motive stands in place of the deed, all through the Methodist writers. God's more concerned about what you meant to do than what you actually did. Now, in your humanists, you're going to find yourself apologizing, embarrassing yourself. But you know what? I could go to Brother Parker, and he's been playing with me for the last day and a half. We know Brother Parker pretty well. My wife brags that she used to hold him on her lap. Now, my wife's 5 feet tall. If you can imagine it, she used to hold Brother Parker on her lap. So I go up and I want to give him just a little jab. But he doesn't get it. When I walk away, everything's fine between him and me. But you know what? In God's eyes, I'm going to have to answer for that because I meant to give him a jab. The motive is more important to God than what you actually accomplished. God knows what your motive is, friend, and that's what you'll answer for. In my Pentateuch class, I wish you could all have a little window and watch it. When we come to Eve at the tree. Students, I said, now when did Eve actually incur guilt? When did she sin? I see them smiling. They know what I'm saying. I say, now, hands don't reach out toward trees without some impulse from the brain. So at some point, that hand starts moving out. It's pretty clear what she's going to do. Did she sin at that point when she's reaching for it? Maybe she's in the clear until she actually touches the forbidden fruit and twists that stem loose. Now it's pretty obvious what's going on. Is that when she sinned? Or maybe when she starts bringing it back, it's even more evident what's going on. Maybe that's when she sinned. Maybe she's in the clear until she actually bites through it, chews it up, and swallows it. And I'll ask him now, and there's hands all over the place. Everybody votes for something. And every once in a while, I've got a Sharpie that's heard me preach somewhere, and he'll say, no, she sinned And here's the answer, class. She sinned before she moved a muscle. The minute she gave the consent of her will to do it, God says, you bought the farm, as we'd say back home. You say, well, that sounds good. Can you prove it? Well, let's see what Jesus says in the Sermon on the Mount. He said, you have heard it hath been said, thou shalt not commit adultery. But he says, I say unto you, that whoso merely looketh upon a woman to lust after her, he's already bought the farm. He's as guilty, he's guilty of the sin of adultery. You say, well, he never moved a muscle. How could he? Because God, and only God, knows the motive in his heart. And the minute he said, I would if I could, if my wife wouldn't catch me, if my church wouldn't find out about it, and only you and God knows when that point is crossed. And we've got sensitive young people that are a little bit in confusion on this. Finished a class one day a year or two ago. A boy came into class. Afterwards, he said, I want to talk to you. Came down to my office. He said, Dr. Kauffman, he says, I don't know if I'm in trouble or not. He said, I was walking down Gomez Avenue, and he said there was a beautiful woman there. She wasn't dressed very well. Very, very, a lot of skin showing. He said, I felt bad about it. Said he'd come over, went to class. Said he'd been sitting here thinking all the way through class. Did I sin? I said, well, that's not hard to figure out. I said, you can't help what you see, but you get to choose what you look at. Can you make that distinction in your mind? I mean, God's given you a pair of cameras here, a pair of lenses. Wherever something's got light on it, your eye will pick it up. You can't help that to see it. But you get to choose what you look at. So I said, let me help you out. Did you take a second look? Did you slow up? Did you turn around? If you were in a car, did you look in your rearview mirror for another look? No, I said, I didn't do anything. I said, then you're in the clear. Sometimes the temptation can be so real, you almost feel like somehow you sinned. He said, well, that's helpful. God alone knows when you would give consent of your will to do something, to think something you shouldn't. We don't need to be walking around unclear about this. I was sitting in the conference office today. I happened to have the Bible Methodist Discipline. Just thought I would see what they had to say about sin. Thank you, Brother Parker. Let me read to you what Article 6, Sin, Original Sin, and Acts of Sin says. We believe that acts of sin are committed by morally responsible persons choosing to do what they know is wrong or choosing not to do what they know is required. These acts of sin are therefore, watch this, not to be confused with shortcomings, infirmities, faults, mistakes, failures, or other such deviations from a standard of perfect conduct, which are the residual effects of the fall. I say again, God is more concerned about what you meant to do than what you actually did. Let me give you an example or two. A few years ago, we were on one of our trips to Israel, trying to get ready to go. We were flying Saturday night out of JFK Airport, 10 minutes till midnight. Problem is, in northeastern Ohio, we had a blizzard all afternoon. I didn't think the plane would get off the ground, but you never know. Sometimes they get the runways cleared off. So my daughter and son-in-law drove wife and me to the Canton Akron Airport. I mean, you can't miss a trip to Israel by just guessing, not sure if they're going to go or not. So we got ready, got there. Sure enough, no, all flights are canceled. Nobody's going anywhere. It's interesting, we rented a car to drive a quarter of a mile away to a motel to spend the night. When I turned the car in the next morning, I had 2 miles on it. That was my rental. Paul called me from JFK Airport. He said, I'm going down the runway now to get on my LL flight. He said, there are 13 of you. There are 3 in Cleveland. There are several of you in Columbus. 2 or 3 of you here. One guy rented a car. He's driving. But he said, we've got standby reservations for you tomorrow. Long story short, next morning we flew to LaGuardia. Sunday morning, 9 o'clock, we're sitting at JFK Airport. I've got a half a dozen students from Ashland Seminary with me. My wife had packed a lunch for us. We knew it would be the Lord's Day. Well, my students, they didn't have any problem with buying on the Lord's Day. And we had to wait for the ticket agent to come in at El Al. So somebody said, well, let's go down to McDonald's. And I follow along. I'm dragging along our luggage with us. We sit down there. My wife opens the sandwich she'd made for us. I said, do you want anything? She said, no. I said, well, I'm going to get a cup of coffee. I got up, walked up, bought myself a cup of coffee, went back and sat down. She said, do you know what day it is? Oh, man, I said, what have I done? This is Sunday morning. I just bought a cup of coffee at McDonald's, JFK Airport. I'm doomed. Did I sin? My motive was not to break the Lord's Day. Big mistake. Big infirmity. But you know what? I never did. I felt embarrassed about it, but never felt condemned about it. Let me give you another one. I'm on my way to Vermontville camp. I had my new $144 Apple phone, Walmart's. I think they've gone up in price. I haven't bought an Apple phone in a while. I'm driving along Interstate 90, somewhere between Rochester and Syracuse. It occurred to me this Apple phone's got FaceTime on it. I punched in my home phone. Siri, call home or something. My wife's on the phone. Honey, I said, get back to my office. When that computer starts beeping or something, click on it, and I'm going to call you. And I did it. And all of a sudden, she said, well, honey, I can see you. I said, well, yeah, I see you too. For half an hour, we're going down Interstate 90. I'm keeping the speed limit. I see the police going by. I never gave it a thought. I said, honey, here's the countryside. It's just so cool. We're talking on FaceTime. The next afternoon, I get up to Vermontville camp, maybe the following morning down the dining hall. I'm telling the teenagers how neat this is. They said, you were doing what on Interstate 90? Yes, FaceTiming my wife. They said, do you know what the penalty for that is? In New York State, something like $10,000. I said, what? Do you know what, people? I was guilty of a crime, but I wasn't guilty of a sin. Again, I was embarrassed, mortified. And those cute guys asked me, did you FaceTime on the way home? No, I didn't do it anymore after that. I finally found out what it was. Did I sin? No, but I committed a crime. I'll give you another example. Talking about carnal traits. When we were in that little storefront, by the way, I have no idea what time it is, and I'm not even going to look at my watch. You still with me? So, Brother Russell Dunn was our pioneer supervisor, good general evangelist. We love Brother Dunn. He and his wife, they took that Hammond spinet organ, slid it on the back of that pickup truck. They'd go around, she'd play the organ, they'd sing. So he was my pioneer supervisor. I remember he came down to Hagerstown. We had just barely got unloaded off the truck, and he was there Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday night. And he told this illustration from his own life. And I've checked it out later to make sure I have it right. He said, I was newly saved, living in Michigan. He's a big fellow. Working on a farm. He's a hired farmhand. And he and the farmer on the barn floor redecking a farm wagon. Big long wagon, these long boards on it. The farmer's on one side. Russ is on this side. They're putting three nails in a board. And as they're working along nailing, it turns into a little unofficial contest, the hired hand against the farmer. And it's pretty clear the hired hand's gonna win. He started pulling ahead. And just as it was clear that he can outdo the farmer said, okay, Russ, it's time to go feed the chickens. Stop the contest rather than be embarrassed. Brother Dunn said, he said, that made me so mad. He said, I pulled back that 23-ounce roughing hammer, and he said, I heaved that thing against the barn door. And then he said, what have I done? And he went out in the hayfield, knelt down, asked God what was going on, apologized, felt bad about it. Now, I was discussing this with somebody who should remain anonymous, but he's sitting here tonight. And we were talking about this. I said, you know, really, he didn't sin. I said, that was a carnal manifestation. He said he threw that hammer. I think it split one of the boards in the door. Said, of course it was sin. Anger is sin. No, I said, he didn't sin. I said, because to sin, you got to know something is wrong, and you got to choose to do it. Now, I'm sure he knew it was wrong to throw hammers, because he went out and talked to the Lord about it right after he did it. And I asked him years later, I said, Brother Dunn, when you pulled back to throw that hammer, did you stop and think, now, I know it's wrong to throw hammers, but I'm going to give myself permission to throw this one to him that knoweth to do good and doeth not to him of sin. I said, did you stop and think, why, Paul, he said, it happened so fast, he said, it kind of scared myself that I did it. I said, well, you've just made my point for me. I said, that was a carnal manifestation. It's interesting, let me just divert for a minute. On the first night of Theology of Holiness class, I have students sit down and write me five sins that you might have committed, you or somebody else. Give me five carnal traits, and give me five temptations. And they'll jot them down, then they start erasing them, then they change them, they move around. And finally, I got 15 answers, and I'll take those answers to my office afterwards, and I'm telling you, my heart sinks. They don't know the difference between a temptation and a carnal trait and a sin. How in the world are they going to get out and help others? And what bothers me is these young people have come up through our camp meetings, our holiness churches, many of them in our academies, homeschool, and they don't know the difference between a carnal trait and a sin and a temptation. So I said to this individual, he said, well, of course it was a sin. Now, he says, what if there had been a window there, and he'd have thrown that hammer through that window, and outside in the street was a mother pushing a stroller with a baby in it. If that hammer had hit that baby and killed it, said it'd be a murder. Therefore, it had to be a sin. Ah, I said, you're wrong. I said, let me change the scenario. Let's suppose there's a mother out there pushing a baby in a stroller, and there's a mad dog about to jump on that baby, and that hammer hits the dog, kills the dog, and saves the baby's life. Now he's a hero. I said, your problem is you cannot judge the rightness or the wrongness of an act by its outcome. Some of you are getting it. I teach ethics at Malone University. There's two ways of making an ethical choice. One is based on the outcome you want to achieve. That's called the teleological approach. That means if you have a problem and you want to solve it, doesn't matter if you do it right or wrong. If you solved it correctly, then that was the way you made your choice. The deontological comes from the Greek word, it means duty-oriented, and it says, before I make this choice, I already know what's right or wrong, and that's the one I'm going to go with. Would to God we would always make our ethical choices that way. This is what God's word says, or this is what my conscience tells me, and I'm going to walk in the light of it regardless of the results. I'll give you an example. It's a crude one. I have it in my book. Let's suppose down at the university there's a young couple, and they're messing around, and they're careless. She finds out she's pregnant. The teleological approach would say, we can't afford this kid. We both have educations to get. Therefore, based on the outcome we need, we'll use a teleological approach and we'll do the abortion. They're making their choice based on the outcome they need, regardless of the consequences. The Christian says, nope, it's wrong to do that, and I can't do it. I don't know what the results are going to be. God help us to make the decisions the right way. So you cannot make your choices based on the outcome you want, and you can't judge the rightness or the wrongness of things based on how they worked out. The hammer that killed the dog and saved the baby's life doesn't make it right or wrong. You say, well, look how it ended up. That doesn't matter. The question is, where did you start out? What light did you have? What light were you not walking in? And I'm here to tell you, God can help you to walk in your light, friend. You can go to bed at night knowing, today I walked in all my light. Satan will mess with you. He'll play games with you like the boy who saw the woman along Gomez Avenue. Satan would love to hamper you, hold you back, tie you up, trying to falsely accuse you. And you know what the answer really is. Well, Is it wrong to pick up sticks on the Sabbath? It wasn't the book of Numbers. One man went out and picked up sticks and he died for it. A lot of Sundays I'll go out to the wood pile and get some wood put on the stove for my wife and I. What's the difference? Well, one is legal, one is ethical. You can't judge something. Let me give you one more example. Some of you still, I tell you, still processing this. Carnal traits here, and I'm gonna start winding this up. In our church in Hagerstown, when we built it, the windows were fairly low. We did it that way for architectural purposes on the outside because it wasn't that big of a building. It made the building look bigger, actually. And there wasn't frosted windows. You could sit in the pew and look out in the parking lot. Let's suppose you're sitting there someday. I want to show you how a carnal trait works. Let's suppose you're sitting there someday and you look out the window. He bought a 1977 used, it was several years old, but it was mint condition. A big black, white Lincoln town car. In fact, that's the one that Dr. Paul Peake used to drive, that big town car. Warren Graves, a farmer, bought that, drove it into the church there. Let's suppose you're sitting there and you see that big Continental, and you had devotions that day, you love the Lord, you're a new convert, and you say, wow, that's quite a buggy he's driving. Well, I wonder what he paid for that. Wonder how he feels driving something like that. And you sit there and those thoughts keep going through the new convert's mind. And the Lord says to him, son, what's going on here? A little jealousy here. Not good. I could help you with that. Now jealousy is a carnal trait. Nobody says, well, I know it's wrong to be jealous, but I'm going to sit here and give myself permission to get into my jealousy mood. Okay, now I'm going to be jealous. You don't do that. You're not even aware of it until the Lord talks to you about it. That's the difference between sins and carnal traits. The Methodist aphorism is this: the motive stands in place of the deed. If you don't get anything else out of tonight, God's more interested in what you meant to do and what you actually did, and that's what you'll answer for. It doesn't mean it won't create problems between your fellow man if you mess it up in the process, but the final analysis, God is more interested with what you meant to do. Progressive revelation showed up in our forefather Wesley. You know, when Wesley first had his conversion, May the 24th, 1738, he starts talking about perfect love. Entire sanctification is not part of his vocabulary early on. But Wesley, if you read him closely in his journals, in his letters, in his sermons, the early Wesley, we call him a pessimistic Wesley, because he didn't think you'd find perfect love till you had sought for half a lifetime or more. Somewhere near the end of the trail. I'm not sure how Wesley thought you'd know when you were getting near the end, but he said, you know, you can start trusting God to do it near the end of the trail. That was the early Wesley. That was a pessimistic Wesley. But Wesley, he applies what we call in theology the quadrilateral. That's not his term. Albert Outler used that term. When Wesley came to a passage of Scripture, he wasn't sure what to do with it. He had four ways of dealing with it. I guess this is the difference between a biblical theologian and a systematic theologian. Wesley says, use all the language tools you can. If it's New Testament, read all the Greek, look at all the lexicons, everything. Make sure you know what the verse actually says. Then you go to all the commentaries, starting with his Moravian friends and the Puritans and the Catholic mystics, all the way back to the first generation church fathers. Still not satisfied. Now he checks it against reason. Is it logical? Will it hold water? And then the last thing for Wesley was experience. Does it work? So Wesley's been teaching for years that you don't get sanctified until you've sought for years and years and years. But when he goes out and starts visiting the societies and the bands and the classes, he hears them testifying they were getting sanctified in a matter of months or weeks or days. And in my own book, I have it right out of his works. I had the citation at the bottom of the page. He tells a woman who got saved about 10 o'clock in the morning. She was a lady of class, an aristocrat, and her brother leads her to the Lord by mid-morning. In the afternoon, she's aware of a deeper need, and by 4 o'clock in the afternoon, Wesley says she's entirely sanctified. And so he says this, since it's by faith, why not now? So we call him now an optimistic Wesley. You see how he had to come to the light of that and work with it over how many years before he starts preaching that it can be anytime your faith is strong enough to reach out and touch it, the optimistic Wesley. Well, I think I'm going to wrap this thing up. I want to say one more thing to you guys, and I've been around long enough I can say this. Now, I teach in a seminary. I've been at Ashland for 30-some years. You young men, you finish your Bible education, your Bible school education, you got all the tools you need to get out and win this world for the lost, for the Lord. You don't need seminary degrees. And all the graduate faculty said, boo, right? You just think somehow I can do a better job if I at least get a master's degree. Forget it. You've learned enough to handle the Word of God. Get out. It's a hungry world waiting on you. Now, if God leads you into further education, like he did me after about 8 or 10 years of preaching, that's different. I became a professional student for about 15 years. I have enough degrees now that 75 cents and all those degrees will get me a senior decaf at McDonald's. That's just a trick of the devil to get you sidetracked, friends. Now, I've told fellas, get out and start a church if you want to get something going. Get a graduate class, put it on the back burner, it'll give you something to work. Maybe do your devotion alongside it or something, that's fine. But this idea that I got to wait and get a degree, listen, I see them in seminary, I see them in graduate school, and you know what? They get a lot of gray matter between the ears, but I don't see a red hot heart after they get those degrees. And I'm serious. And Brother Frank, I'm just going to close with that advice, okay? You don't need graduate degrees to be a soul winner. You've got all the tools you need. The curriculum at all of our Bible colleges have balanced out well enough to give you all you need to get out and win the world. And so I don't know what time it is, but I'm going to sit down. It's up to you. God bless you.